Welcome to the Zero to $5 Million Podcast. I'm Sean Finder, and I'm with my co-host, Ollie Whitfield. This show is brought to you by Autoklose, a vanilla soft company. Ollie, why don't you, we don't have a guest today, but why don't you tell the audience what we're going to be talking about?
Yeah, well, I've been thinking a lot about how our reply rates, just generally speaking, across any email outreach that anybody's doing. What is generally good? What's not? Is it going up? Is it going down? So I know that you and our team send cold emails, obviously, because that's what our tools allow us to do. It's obviously what our customers are doing. So you probably hear a lot of feedback from them, what else you see across the industry. But obviously, you're going to have some different ideas and tips than I might to increase your reply rate. So that might be a good debate to have too. But generally, what's your feeling? What's your pulse on the topic? Like, what is a decent or all right standardized reply rate?
So here's what I would look at. I would say 25% of cold email campaigns, these are cold, have a 20+% reply rate. I would say 10% or under is about 50%. And I think between 10 and 20% would be about 25. So I would say the majority are under 10%, and then 25 between 10 and 20, and about 25 between 20 plus. There are some that go over 30, but I would say generally that it's that 20% reply rate.
So is that Autoklose, or is that something you've read?
Well, it's just something I've read. I mean, it all depends. I mean, Autoklose statistics, that those were, as you take an average, that's what it is. I mean, but that all depends on, you know, your subject line and other stuff. But I mean, I've seen some campaigns that get in the 30s, but I've also seen some campaigns that get, you know, under 10 for me personally. So I think it all depends on the vertical you're emailing. I know we once did a campaign to automobile dealerships, and I guess they don't read many emails because we had under 10%. But then if you do it, you know, a tech company, HR, et cetera, insurance, for example, who people are always on their computer, they're either always on the computers or phones, I've seen up to, you know, 36, 37% as well.
Okay. So that's campaign, right? You said, or is that per email? Okay. I was thinking, what? 30%? What planet is he on? But no, I was thinking in my mind, but it's interesting you said campaign. Generally what I've heard, interested what you think of this, per email, and it kind of depends how many emails you have in a campaign to make up that number. Per email, if you're getting 1%, that's probably like about what's normal. If you're getting less, that's a sign of it's not that good and you should change it. Maybe it's the subject line is nearly always something to do with it, or maybe it's just too long or something fairly obvious. And beyond, sort of when you get to 5% and beyond, good job. Like, keep it as it is, maybe experiment if you want to, or try and squeeze some more. But beyond 5% per email, looking good.
Now, let's actually go back a second. When I was actually talking, forgot me, having my coffee, when I was thinking reply rates, I was thinking open rates.
Oh my gosh, bro.
So reply rates, I would say the average is between 1% to 3% actually. And that's actually what we've seen in Autoklose. If you're over 3%, you said 5. I don't really see, rarely see 5. If you're even at 3, 4%, you're doing pretty good with getting a reply from a cold email. Yeah. But the numbers I did were open rates I find on cold emails.
So let's go back and let's just repackage. So a decent open rate, you're saying maybe around 15, 20, 25%. That's probably what most people get on average. If you're getting above like the 30s, that's really good. Well done. If you're getting below the 10s, probably something to do with your subject line. That's probably a big problem. All right, cool. And then from that, if a 1 to a 3% of those opens, if that generates a reply, that's around standard to good. Beyond that is really good. And below a 1% reply rate is like a...
Yeah.
Maybe it's not even your subject line, because at that point they've got an open, but maybe it's too long. You've got too much of an ask. It's a big ask. Like, could we do an hour demo? An hour is like quite a lot. And people go, no, I don't want to do it. Yeah. It's things like that come into play.
It could be too many CTAs. It could be many things. But yeah, but I would say if you are, even if you're at about the 2 to 3%, you're doing pretty good. It's really under that 1% where you're struggling. But you got to think, you know, email's a numbers game at the end of the day. You know, so if you do 3% of, you know, 1,000 emails, you're getting 30 messages back a day, right? So it is a numbers game.
Yeah. And of course, so we would take out the... Some people don't actually, and then it's like, oh yeah, I got a 41% reply rate. I'm good. But it's like out of office, you know, Memorial Day, or, you know, email's dead and that kind of stuff. So anything that's not about, anything that is about, let's take that out, and then that's your real number. So let's list out some of the things that could harm your reply rate. Obviously, you said too many calls to action, so that kind of the too many choices, so I don't end up picking one. That's one. I always say the really, really long email, like too much. There's like, you don't have to be brief every time, but going too long is kind of too much to digest. Then you don't bother. Any others you got?
I would say too salesy. An email that's very salesy. An email that talks too much about yourself. Not enough about your prospect. I would say subject line, obviously, because if you don't have a good subject line, you're not going to get your body paragraph even written. Personalization would be another one. So personalization meaning, you know, there's a name, high name, but also signature, meaning you have a signature there so they can say, okay, you know, you are the manager of this, work at this company, you have a phone number and email. Your email is not a Gmail, Yahoo, or Hotmail free email domain. It's a more of a B2B domain. So you have that, you know, trust and authority as well. But those would be the different things that I would say will attribute to getting those reply rates up.
Okay. Yeah. Interesting. You said the signature. I often didn't want to put one in just because I think it's like extra spam filter stuff. Like I've got links and images, which is often a spam filter thing to consider. But that said, if I got a blank white screen email with like from Sean who, from where, do I trust that? So yeah, that's another thing. Any way that you can kill trust is a way to kill a reply, isn't it really? So if I sound a bit like off with my accuracy, if I'm saying I'm reaching out to vice presidents of marketing and you're not a vice president of marketing, obviously you're not going to get a reply, are you?
Nope. And also when you said signature, on my emails, when I'm doing internal emails with people I know, I do keep those links. On a cold email, in your signature, do not put those links. And even with your email, don't hyperlink your email. Leave it just in text form. So don't hyperlink it, because what happens is you're only, you know, Google looking at how many links you have in an email. If you're using one, two in your signature, then you're only saving one for your actual email body paragraph. So try not to have any links in there, but you can still type it out as a text in text format inside your signature.
Yeah. Okay. I like that. Good idea. Good concept. Because oftentimes, like, this isn't really about reply rate, but the deliverability, the hit and spam, the hit in the promotions folder is where you've got links and you've been flagged as this is not a person sending an email. This is like a tool sending you a newsletter because it's got so many links. And yeah, that's when you land in the wrong place. Or better yet, you even land in spam and they never ever read it and they delete it. So that's the bad stuff. What about the good stuff? What can you do to drag up your reply rate from maybe like a 0.5% to maybe a 1 and above if we can?
I would always say personalize in the subject line. So make sure you have something in your subject line that's personalized. You know, something with the person's name always works.
Does name work? Just to me, add name, does that increase a little bit, do you think, or no?
I mean, I know, you know, if you just do like, you know, personalize the subject line, like just say, you know, stop Sean, hi Sean, hey Sean, that actually increases your rates by about 41%. So say, for example, you know, by increase by 41%, it's 41%, not on the overall number, on just that variable, right? It does help. I've also read that if you use the company name, so I've seen people do, you know, Autoklose plus Vanilla Soft, it increases by about 35%, 30%, 35%. Those are the statistics. Now, these statistics I'm doing are, you know, stuff I looked at late in 2022. I don't know if they've changed much now, but the personalization, the company name have really done well. And then also doing something with, like, say somebody got a job promotion. They got a new job or they're changing titles. Something with, like, congrats and thanking them or doing something that's showing them, you know, making them feel good, really helps with that subject line. That's increased by typically between 40 to 50%.
Good stats. Not just a pretty face. I'll have to check if they're true, but
Write them down.
Yeah, it was interesting. The company one, I seem to, well, maybe I just notice it because it's something I thought about, but I seem to get that a lot. Like, do you get that a lot? I never really get my name. It's almost like too obvious that I don't do it. But the company, it's always like, how any company, because it's a personalization token, can something, and it's so easy to do, but it's not really related in any sense at all to us. It's just that the company name is there.
See, I used to do it years ago, like, you know, Sean Autoklose plus this. But the problem now is a lot of people use LinkedIn. And the one way I already know right away if somebody...
Can I guess? Because I've seen this a lot. You get like Autoklose LLC or like limited or incorporated companies or some stupid elongation of the name.
Yep. Because my LinkedIn says Autoklose, a vanilla soft company. In my email, I get, hey, I think this would be great for Autoklose, a vanilla soft company. I'm like, well, I just know that you just used a token and put that in, right?
Yeah.
If you would have said Autoklose, I know you didn't scrape it from somewhere. So I get that a lot. And even on LinkedIn, where sometimes they trick me, I'm like, wow, this person's actually messaging me. It's not an automation. They're like, oh, no, they said Autoklose, a vanilla soft company, and somewhere in it, I knew right away it was automated.
So with that, going a little bit away from it, how do you feel about, because I wouldn't personally do this, but I would be interested to see how much it would further flag this up for me. You know how people change their name on LinkedIn and they put like an emoji at the end of their name to catch that? Because it's going to work its way into the high first name and the, like you said, company and a job as well. Actually, job would be interesting because some people have really like wonky titles like vice president, EMEA, healthcare, comma, tech. And you're like, no one would ever write that. You'd just put like VP, wouldn't you? So I wonder how much that would ever show up in my inbox. Have you ever thought about doing that?
I mean, personally, when I used to do cold emails, I would actually always check the different things to make that spreadsheet look as much like it's not automated as possible. Meaning, I know there's people that have their middle name, you know, hi, Sean Jeffrey. My middle name is Jeffrey Finder, right? So when they're saying hi, Sean Jeffrey, I know that they, you know, they A, found me from some sort of database and they automated it. If they said hi, Sean, it's different. The same thing with Autoklose, a vanilla soft company, or any emoji that I have. So I would just, you know, listen, I always tell people with email, if you do the work at the forefront, you'll get more results in the back end. Meaning if you spend the extra time on that spreadsheet, making sure, like I've also seen where people say, hi, Sean, but the Sean, the S will be not capitalized. Well, I know that you just got it from a spreadsheet. So, you know, there's, and sometimes you get those weird characters in your name that you'll see on the spreadsheet and you'll get those as well. So, I mean, do your due diligence, look at the stuff before you're sending. If you're spending the money and the time to send out an email campaign, make sure the name, the contact, the company, the position, everything is accurate as possible before you actually press send.
That's like a little gripe I have. We'll have to move on in a sec. But I just find that everyone says, oh, these email platforms and these companies that let you send emails, they're making everyone do terrible stuff. They're really not. Like, it just makes it easy if you do something quicker. And if you're already doing something stupid, you can do stupid faster. And if you're doing good, you can do good faster. What you just described is do like a Excel sheet, find and replace for the lack of capital letters in the first letter of the first name, or the ampersand, I think is the character that always ends up going wonky in text. So find and replace and put and if you need to put and, or like check all the company names. And if there's like a LLC, find and replace and just delete that bit. Or if there's PLC or limited or whatever, you just delete that bit and it looks normal. Or any hyphens, or I know it's a bit of a data, you know, fun thing to do, but it will look a lot better and it will increase that reply rate, as we said.
And to be honest, I always tell people, like people even ask about Autoklose, I'm like, it's plug and play. Like you can just set up and go, but that doesn't mean that you don't have to set it up. Like you still have to set up who you want to send those emails to, your templates, the dates, the times, all that stuff. But once you do all that stuff at the forefront, you know, it is plug and play. You can sell when you're sleeping. But you got to spend that time to get everything set up properly. So I just feel like a lot of people waste the data they purchase, they use, they build, they get from inbound and even inbound leads. Like if you notice, a lot of people just take the inbound leads, the form, upload into a spreadsheet, then send an email out. Well, when people send out those email, those forms, sometimes they make spelling mistakes. They put weird thing in there. And now you're just emailing off a list. Spend the time, even if it takes a few hours, go through that spreadsheet of 200, 500,000 names. Make sure it's right. And from there, that's when you want to actually send out your campaign.
Yep. And last tip on that, if you really feel like it's too much data admin and that stuff, or you've got too much other stuff to do, you can fiverr.com that for a few bucks, which would probably be a fraction of the cost of your software, which is obviously then proportionately worth it. So anyway, there's that. Let's not mess up on our personalization tokens and that type of stuff that obviously will kill the trust and make you think, yeah, spam email, delete. You're not going to get a reply. I think we've already kind of mentioned the brevity is one thing. You don't have to be really brief, but not making it like an essay because it's too much. No one's going to want to actually read it. They have no reason to, and then they won't reply is one thing. What about too many links? You kind of said that. Why do you think that is a problem for reply rate? And if I trim that down, will it increase it?
Well, because if you have too many links, in your email, it actually goes to spam. So a lot of people don't know that, but links and attachments. So if you have too many attachments, you're sending four different case studies in an email, it most likely in an automated system will go to spam.
I don't often see attachments, do you? True attachments, like you would entirely.
No, but I mean, sometimes you do. Like sometimes in the middle of a campaign, if you want to send out some sort of one pager, you know, people do. But too many links does, and a lot of people don't understand that in your signature, you probably have four or five hyperlinked already. So you're just increasing that number. Take those hyperlinks out of that signature.
Okay, so on reply rate, this would be an interesting one. I know that you're a bit of an advocate for the calendar link, that type of thing, insert whatever tools that you want to use it. How do you think that impacts your reply rate? Do you normally receive like you sent an email to a person, they've booked the call and they don't reply, or do they reply and book the call, or is it a bit of both?
I mean, it's a little saturated market now, but when I first started Autoklose, I would say in like 15, 16 exchange leads and then 17, 18, I would just send out the calendar link and people would even just book on my calendar. I wouldn't even get a reply. Now it's changed. It doesn't work. It's not as effective. But I mean, just like everything, like even just LinkedIn in general, everything's kind of the markets are now more saturated than they were years ago. But it used to just be like, I send an email blast out and I would just get my calendar filled up with demos. It's a little different nowadays because I think a lot of people caught on and started doing it.
Okay. So I'm imagining that would probably be the case. There's no need to take extra time to reply. Once you booked it, that's action done, move on. So yeah, I'm imagining that's one. Unless it's like the very last thing in the campaign and you want to just throw it there and make it easy, or if they've already engaged, that works. And you're not looking for a reply, you're looking for a conversion. But I'm imagining, so the best ways that I would get a reply, I'm asking a question, like, is it worth talking about whatever I have discussed? Is it accurate? When would this be accurate? That type of thing, as to not assume something is currently a thing or a project. What else would you be asking? Because aside from just saying, like, do you want a demo? And then what day would be good? You're kind of going to get the reply or not. What else can you do to get the reply?
I mean, nowadays you can do a lot of things. You can ask different questions about their platform. You can ask who they're using. Are they happy when their contract is up? You can ask what their challenges are. Try and name their challenge. If you can name their challenge, you're probably better yet. But there's a lot of different things you can do to build that rapport. I've also seen where you can send emails just with a simple question to try and get a reply, and you're more likely to get a reply. Hey, just curious, is your sales team using A, B, or C? I saw on your website you guys were using this, but just want to confirm. Boom. You know, who's the decision maker? I know you take care of the VP of sales. Is there someone that, you know, makes a decision? Different one-liners can actually work as well.
There you go. Good tip. I'm out of questions, man. You got anything you want to add, or should we close this up?
I think I would just say, you know, personalization, like you said, short and sweet is the best way to send an email. And remember, it's a numbers game, right? It's different than cold calling, because email you can plug and play, where cold calling you have to get on the phone. But both channels work very well. So if you see 1-3% as your reply rate, don't get discouraged. That's the industry average. Perfect. Well, I want to thank everybody for joining us today. This has been a blast of an episode, and thank you for everybody listening. If you enjoyed the show, don't forget to give us a 5-star review wherever you're listening from. Subscribe so you don't miss the next show, and even reach out to us and let us know if there's any guests you want us to bring on this show. Thanks again, and see you soon.